Johnson's Baby presents The Tara Sharma Show.
Most parents will agree that education gives confidence and teaches us how to think. And one of our biggest responsibilities as parents is to give our children a good education. Today we're going to talk about education for kids, choosing the right schools, the pros and cons of the schooling decisions we make, competition in schools, what we learn from our parents, and so much more. On this episode on Tara's Parenting Powwows, mums from different walks of life discuss the pros and cons of the schooling decisions they made, our experiences and views on our kids' education.
We need to slow down and we need to give them at least some essence of the simple life that we had when we were young.
An engaging chat with Mrs. Sirvai, principal of the Bombay International School, and a tete-a-tete with the amazing actress and my dear friend, Konkana Sen Sharma.
No other rite of passage, you know, of being a human being, I think, comes close to, you know, being a parent or definitely being a mother.
So something that everyone connected to a child is always talking about and definitely very aware of is education. Let's start with the teacher. So you've actually decided to not be a sort of city mom and you've chosen to teach and change your own career as well for the benefit of your child.
I had a child who was very free-spirited and, you know, very in touch with the wilderness and animals and all of that. I thought that, you know, what I wanted for him as education was more than just a school. I wanted a space, a universe that he could inhabit and feel one with. And somehow, the more I looked in the city, I didn't find that space. That's how I finally ended up where I am now, which is I'm teaching at a residential school.
So Nandini, what do you feel about education?
I think we're fortunate to be in cities now where there are many great schools, there are many great programs. Our kids have way more opportunities than we did. And we need to, you know, open those worlds to them.
When it comes to the admission process, is there anything that you've faced in that space that you'd like to share?
I had to take admission for my son when he turned 3 months old. And a friend of mine who had a son who was 10 months old was told that she was late for an admission to a certain nursery.
Oh gosh,
which gets a little challenging for us because when you're a new mother and you're still learning about what needs to be done, you're still getting used to the fact of changing diapers every couple of hours, and then you have to think about the education which is going to start 3 years later. But you still need to register and go through that entire process. And it's not just one nursery. You have to register to about at least 5 or 6 in the city.
I think there's this joke going that in some places you have to register the minute you find out you're pregnant.
Because there's a waiting list.
You
see, so this kind of thing is quite frightening. Because I think there is definitely a difference between when we were kids and I think how it is now. Having said that, what do you feel about the parental stress that happens?
It's incredible. The parents are just wired before these exams. There's this constant, you know, let's send them for tuitions at 3 years old and let's put them in 400 classes. The children are exhausted when they come home. They don't know how to free play anymore. We need to slow down and we need to give them at least some essence of the simple life that we had when we were young.
There is definitely a difference between when we were kids and I think how it is now. Having said that, there's also a view that in many countries, and in fact, I think even when we were kids, there was less of a pressure to send them so young. What is your view on that?
I think children, you know, younger than 4 or 3 and a half have no business to be in school. Really. I mean, I think it's so cruel to just pack them off like that. But, you know, there are sometimes you have to just succumb to that system because you have to start at a certain age.
I personally found very honestly that my kids actually really enjoyed going because it was more like a play thing. You know, it was just a bunch of kids meeting and having fun.
They start out with that objective in mind, you know, the schools that accept children at that age. But what they try and do is that because they have a bunch of kids, then they have an agenda, then they start not forcing, but sort of pushing them to learn certain things when they are not really ready for. And then there is this sort of homogeneity of, okay, there is a bunch of children, so they have to be in a certain, because they have to show in their books that, you know, they have learned X, Y, Z. They have to have enough material to write those reports so that, you know, they can quantify it at the end of the year. I think that's not necessary. I think children going to a space where they feel free and they have fun and they are learning in the process, but in a very subliminal way, is a good thing. But I think this whole, at what age should a child know the alphabet? I don't think a child needs to know the alphabet at age 4. Then it becomes, you know, then they keep pushing the boundaries, you know.
But what about if a child wants to? Like, I found quite early on, they would want to kind of read the paper or read what it was. And that's where I found phonics. And I thought that was fantastic. It taught me. And we were told, don't teach your kids because you'll teach them wrong. Let them come home and teach you, if at all. So I quite like that philosophy of, don't push them, definitely don't send them to classes, but let them kind of tell you.
My son was 18 months when I put him in play school and he absorbed it like a sponge. I mean, he loved going to school. He was so young. He took to everything. As a working mother also, it was important for me to have him in an educational environment and then come back and have that quality time with him.
I think that's a good point to bring, because it's also about how much time you have as a parent to give. And I think also when we talk about education, we tend to focus on schools and the system and the board. Whereas actually, somebody recently said to me that half, if not more, of the education actually happens at home. Is there anything you'd like to say?
Well, I've learned a lot from both the experienced mothers and yourself. So I'm going to keep that in mind going forward with my son. And I look forward to everything that the world has to offer in terms of his education and his experiences.
We live in a very fast-paced world. And I think there's nothing like spending time with your children. So slow down, be the teacher yourself, and then the education system will support that.
I think the universe is your education. So give your child as many experiences as possible of very different textures and all, and enjoy yourself in the process. It's a lovely ride.
I've learned so much. This has been an education to me. I believe everything we do in life is an education. And, you know, you use what you've learned in whatever you do. Thank you so, so, so much for being here.
Thank you.
Both Rupak and I were brought up with the strong value of the importance of a good education. Of course, our kids are very little now and are just at the nursery and primary school phase. But perhaps because Rupak and I had what we consider great opportunities with our education, we'd like our kids to have that and more.
What's this then? Apart from playing in the garden and going for playdates and stuff, something he really loves doing is going to the race course. Because Zen loves horses and dogs. Yes, dogs.
In our case, choosing schools best suited to our kids was not such a struggle because we were both quite clear on the schools we were looking at, and we were very lucky that our kids got in there.
I truly believe there is no best school anymore. That best school concept doesn't exist. But I think the key here is wherever your child is accepted and wherever your child is happy is the end result to everything. So you could have a child going to the top schools in our city who are unhappy for various reasons. And you could be, you could have a school which could be a small little school where your kid is going to and be supremely happy. So it is about your kid being happy where he or she is.
We believe a big part of education happens at school. So choosing a school that suits your child's personality and your own values is important. Not necessarily a school that everyone's going to. Also, a large part of education happens at home.
What's the capital of Thailand?
Bangkok.
You see, now what is this one?
Ka
for?
Dad.
And whether we like it or not, we as parents are our children's first role models. It's not always easy to be a good role model. In fact, I'm often scolding myself for not being a good one. But as the saying goes, your children become who you are. So be who you want them to be. Coming up next, a chat with Mrs. Mona Sirvai, principal of the Bombay International School.
If you ask any child what they remember about school, a child will always tell you, I remember that teacher and what she said to me.
And today we are with the wonderful principal of the Bombay International School and a super mom to her two grown-up children, Mrs. Sirvai. Thank you so much, Mrs. Sirvai, for being on the show.
Thank you, Tara. It's my pleasure to be here.
So, Mrs. Sirvai, how did you become a teacher? What made you be a teacher?
Ken Robinson has written this wonderful book called The Element. And he basically says you should just find what is your passion in life. And once you find that, then you are in your element. And for me, teaching is just absolutely what I always wanted to do.
I think it's amazing to be able to find your passion and be in your element.
Yes.
So what are some of the challenges you face as a teacher and as a principal?
There are two different things. I am a teacher and a principal.
Yes.
And one of the biggest challenges is balancing both. And I think being a good role model is a real challenge because it's sort of creating a vision for the school. It's trying to give a direction for the future.
Yes.
If you ask any child what they remember about school, a child will always tell you, no matter how old, I remember that teacher and what she said to me.
That's so true. When it comes to curriculum, the IB, for a lot of people, they see it as a niche board, if you like, especially here, because it's now gaining momentum. And, you know, we've heard about how they need certain facilities and
That's the biggest myth.
Exactly.
Because the IB is not about structures. It's a philosophy.
Yeah.
So it's really a philosophy and an approach. And the philosophy that the IB really uses is what is called inquiry or concept-based learning, where the teacher is just the facilitator. Today you have information at the click of a button.
Yes.
Or you can get it even from other resources. It doesn't have to be digital. But what you do with that information is vital.
Yes.
And so what the IB is, it's a philosophy by which students learn to question and inquire and make learning their own. And I think people just haven't understood that.
Right.
Because they're looking at it as a really elite board. And what I mean, if you ask me what dream I have, I just wish I could take this method of teaching and this IB philosophy to every child in the country. And so every child should be able to learn that way. And I think what very few people know is that the primary years program was developed by teachers.
Right.
So knowledge is looked at thematically. So within these themes, children learn concepts. So they learn for understanding and they don't learn, you know, to be a factory of information that just then gets spewed out.
But this is so fascinating because I think, again, it teaches us as a parent that we also have to be open to learning.
Yes.
So I think it's important for us to be open to change and to embracing the fact that it's a different world and there are other newer ways and different ways of doing things as well. Is there anything you'd like to say to other mums out there and teachers and principals?
Well, since this is a show about mums, all I can tell other mums is just be there for your kids. You will never know how to be a good mom, but if you're just there, I think that's half the battle won. And for teachers, all I can say is just be open to learning and continue to learn because there's a lot that we can learn from our children.
Thank you. That was lovely. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Tara. Lovely to be here.
Coming up next, a chat with the beautiful Konkana Sen Sharma.
What's your view on the education
system? Too hard, you know, it's too hard. I don't know. There's too many things to worry about. There's no perfect school.
And for today's tete-a-tete, we have the super talented actress, a wonderful mom, and a very dear friend, Konkana Sen Sharma. So Coco, how did you feel when you first became a mom?
You know, nothing I think prepares you for the moment that you become a mother. I remember when Harun first came out, I took some time, you know, to get used to him and to get used to the idea that I'm a mom, to get used to the idea that, you know, I've said goodbye to sleep for 1 year. But I think looking back now, I think I just fall in love a little bit more with my son every day. I think it wasn't so much in the beginning.
But that's amazing. But that first moment when you held him, was he crying? Was he screaming?
He was crying, you know? He was crying and he was all kind of, he was warm
and
fleshy. Yeah, he was smelling of flesh. And he was warm and he was wrinkled and he was grey. And you know when they're ugly
they
come out?
Yeah, they have some kind of, there's some stuff
crying.
On them.
There's stuff on them. They hadn't cleaned him.
Yeah, they put him on it.
And they put him on me. As soon as they put him on me, he stopped crying.
So that was the first kind of surge of connection. And then...
And the power you have over him.
And the power I wield now.
But it's interesting because no one tells you that. You know, like we see the first few pictures of these gorgeous, gorgeous little cute babies with their little caps on and
yeah.
stuff. But that first...
They don't prepare you for that because even though you know that they come out ugly and wrinkled, you imagine them red and, you know, like pink or red or something. Nothing prepares you for that. You know, when your skin has
that
been in water for a long time,
yeah.
which they have, then your skin is wrinkled and grey.
So, has motherhood been a sort of life-changing thing for you? Or do you think you're still, in essence, the same person? Or do you think you've changed in a big way? Or
I've changed. I've changed, definitely. I think you grew up. I think you just grew up. Because before that, it's like, you know, you're this extended childhood, you know, waking up as late as you want, whenever you want. It's lovely. And, you know, thinking really mainly just about your own concerns. Having children is like a benchmark, you know. It's,
yeah.
it's a turning point. It's one of those, I mean, no other rite of passage, you know, of being a human being, I think, comes close to, you know, being a parent or definitely being a mother.
Yeah.
I think it's just, everything in my life is divided into before and after. It takes a long time. I don't think anybody can really prepare you. It's really tough.
Harun, of course, is quite little now. But what about education? What's your view on the education
system? It's too hard, you know. It's too hard at all. Like, I don't know. There's too many things to worry about. There's no perfect school. So this is the thing. I've been, you know, now, you know, asking people around a lot. I'm happy. It's a small little school. But I know he can't be there, you know, forever. It's only till class 4 or 5. So I've been finding out about different schools. You know, and the thing is that I think every school comes with its own set of problems. And, you know, actually, who odd? Adhanakhtar, she told me something very nice. She said, you know, whatever school you send your child to, they're going to have some shortcomings which you're going to have to make up for at home.
Yes,
you know,
absolutely.
So whether
agree.
It's the, you know, sports angle that they're not pushing, or it's too competitive, or it's too small, or it's too big and they're lost in it, or they don't pay attention to, you know, whatever it is, you have to make up for it at home. So
completely.
I tell myself that to comfort myself.
Yeah. No, but I completely agree. And I think every school has its pros and cons. Personally, I'm very happy with our kids' schools.
Yeah.
And as you said, you make up for things at home, and also the schools make up for things that you may not be doing. So I think there's always a fine balance.
Yeah.
Have you ever considered homeschooling?
No, not yet.
That would be like...
That's scary, no? Homeschooling is scary. My mother briefly considered it when I was young.
Really?
Yeah, she briefly considered it. And then, you know, I think my sister talked her out of it. Because I think homeschooling is great. I mean, I really have a lot of admiration for people who can do homeschooling. But it's... I think it requires like a lot of investment, a lot of involvement, and to sustain.
And a lot of patience.
You know, a lot
and
of patience.
To be able to do it. I mean, I have
to... And to sustain it for like 12 years, 15 years. You know, I mean, at least 12 years, right?
So
that's hard.
No, and
that's
hard. As somebody who works, as I think that, to
exactly.
be honest, the time that the kids go to school...
Yeah.
Especially in the
I
beginning
so
is the time.
Done.
Yeah, is when you can do so much. And not that you're kind of pushing that away, but I think personally you're kind of a nicer parent when you've had some time
Absolutely.
To do your stuff and then
Absolutely.
You're back with them and you know it's all lovely and hunky dory. So Coco, is there anything you'd like to say to all the mums out there?
Oh.
Any tips, any mummy gyan?
I think the most important thing is to, you know, is to keep your cool and to, you know, make sure you prioritize on your sleep. Because then I think that you can handle things. You love your kid. You're going to do your best for your kid. You have your own life. You've lived so many years, you know, on your own. I mean, I think everyone's okay. Everyone's figured that out. But I think everything gets compromised because you're stressed out. Because there's so many expectations, you know, to fulfill. There's so much pressure.
Yeah.
It's a stressful situation. You're not sleeping enough. So I think that early time, early motherhood, which was difficult for me. I think the first 6 months to 1 year was difficult for me. In hindsight, I think at the time I didn't realize. I don't know if I was depressed. Or maybe I wasn't depressed, but maybe because I wasn't sleeping enough, I found that difficult. So I think just to, you know, just to prioritize on sleep and focus on some me time.
Yeah.
You know, regardless of, you know, 1 or 2 or 3 children or husband or whatever. I think that's important.
Yeah. And you are looking so amazing, I have to say. And
look
Coco,
at you.
Thank you so, 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 so much for
thank
being on the
you.
Show.
Thank
Always
you.
A pleasure.
I'm so happy. And I hope we do many, many, many more seasons
of course.
Together.
Thank you. It may sound cliched, but the truth is my children are my biggest teachers. Every day, every experience shared with them teaches me so much as a mother. Next week, a discussion with parents who have married into different cultures about the parenting decisions they've made.
I think in terms of having children, it's important to agree upfront on basic things like how you bring up the child.
And so we decided that they were not going to be British or Indian. They were just going to be our children.
a look into our family's mixed background. And finally, Mini Mathur's perspective on raising her children and lots more.
Kids, when they were born, thankfully, nobody asked us to put on a form what religion we'd like them to be, because for me and Kabir, we don't believe that children should be born to a religion.
Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel, The Tara Sharma Show. And do keep writing in to our social media platforms and interacting with me. I'd love to hear your views on all this and more.